Bona tarda, benvinguts a l'Institut d'Estudis Catalans i a la Societat Catalana d'Economia, en concret, per assistir o participar, més ben dit, en aquesta sessió amb la que el professor Giorgos Kallis ens parlarà dels Ecological Economics and the Case for the Growth. Abans de presentar el professor Giorgos Kallis, que potser no els necessita per vostès, i ja ho faré després, en anglès. Primer els vull recordar que la nostra Societat Catalana d'Economia és una societat filial de l'Institut d'Estudis Catalans que es dedica a promoure i a divulgar la recerca en ciència econòmica. I precisament en aquest aspecte, la conferència d'avui del professor Giorgos Kallis fa front precisament en aquest aspecte de divulgar la recerca que el professor Giorgos Kallis, junt amb altres, està fent en el ICTA, l'Institut Català de Tecnologia Ambiental. Què fem a la Societat Catalana d'Economia amb aquesta línia general? Doncs fem moltes conferències. La propera tindrà lloc el dia 24 de maig, un dimarts, aquí, no en aquesta sala, en una altra sala, però tindrà lloc el dimarts 24 de maig, amb la que se'ns parlarà de les aportacions que el recentment laureat Premi Nobel d'Economia, Angus Deaton, ha fet precisament en l'estudi dels desequilibris amb la distribució de riquesa de la renda també i de les seves conseqüències. Això ens en parlarà el professor Ramos, et repeteixo, el dia 24 de maig, el dimarts 24 a les 7 de la tarda. I després hi ha la següent sessió, ja serà en el mes de juny, que tindrà lloc el professor Silvestre, que ens parlarà també d'un tema de la seva especialització científica. I amb això donarem per acabat aquest curs fins l'any que ve. Any que ve, en el qual tenim un punt clau, que és com que celebrem els 30 anys de la Societat Catalana d'Economia com a tal, tot i que la seva existència és prèvia, tindrà lloc un congrés català de recerca en economia, el Catalan Economic Science Society, Catalan Economic Society Congress, amb el qual el CESC, que n'hi diem nosaltres, el CESC, amb el qual durant un dia voldrem resumir les aportacions que economistes catalans han fet i estan fent a la ciència econòmica. Això és el punt clau, serà el punt màxim d'activitat de l'any que ve, tot i que també seguirem amb forces conferències. Repeteixo, això és el que fem a la Societat Catalana d'Economia. Dintre de la Societat Catalana d'Economia hi ha grups de treball, working groups, en els quals s'incorporen socis per col·laborar amb nosaltres, i un d'aquests grups és el d'Economia Crítica i de Gènere, que el porta un membre de la Junta de Govern de la Societat, que és la Lourdes Beneria, a la qual demanaré ara que ens expliqui què fan el grup de treball d'Economia Crítica i de Gènere. Lourdes, si em pots explicar en 2 minuts, apreta el botonet.
Quatre paraules per parlar una mica del grup aquest. Que funciona dintre de la Societat Catalana d'Economia juntament amb altres grups. Li diem grup d'economia crítica i d'economia de gènere, o sigui, no més crítica i gènere, sinó també d'economia de gènere. I aquesta conferència d'avui l'hem organitzat nosaltres. Ja va venir, ja fa un parell, quasi un parell d'anys que funciona. L'any passat va venir i va parlar el Jordi Roca de la Universitat de Barcelona sobre economia ecològica. Avui la conferència d'avui cau també sobre un tema com a mínim relacionat, però és que a part de qüestions relacionades amb la crisi ecològica mundial i el que tenim a l'entorn nostre, També ens interessen molts altres temes, com per exemple qüestions de desigualtat. Començaria primer potser per qüestions de mercat de treball, tot tipus de qüestions relacionades amb el mercat de treball i desigualtat, la qüestió de desigualtat en particular, que ja no solament desigualtat de gènere, sinó tot tipus de desigualtats que inclou des de Piketty fins a l'economia de cura, que té també un aspecte de gènere. I naturalment hi ha molts altres temes que cauen dintre dels interessos del grup, com per exemple qüestions relacionades amb la teoria econòmica i de sobretot de com s'ensenya a les nostres universitats la teoria econòmica, crítiques de la teoria ortodoxa i sobretot el predomini el domini de la teoria ortodoxa en l'ensenyança de l'economia. També qüestions que toquen el grup que aquí tenim també d'economia internacional, per exemple, comerç internacional, finances internacionals, qüestions ja més concretes com el TTIP en aquest moment. Tenim també interès sobretot sobre alternatives econòmiques en aquest moment que estem tant de transició d'un moment a l'altre i a Espanya en particular, uns temes que els sentim cada dia i que s'han de tractar en profunditat, etc. O sigui, hi ha tots aquestes qüestions i voldria aprofitar aquest moment per dir-vos que si us interessa, tant ser com part del grup com per, si sou membres de la Societat Catalana d'Economia i com si ens volguéssiu ajudar a suggerir gent o suggerir a gent que es poden adreçar a un d'aquests temes o temes que voldríeu que la societat tractés, etc, etc. O sigui, aprofito aquest moment per donar-vos també les gràcies de que sigueu aquí avui i ja passo la paraula a l'Eduard.
Moltes gràcies, Lourdes. Jo aprofito el que ha dit Lourdes perquè els que no sou socis de la Societat Catalana d'Economia i esteu interessats en el nostre objectiu de promoure i divulgar la recerca que potser molts de vosaltres feu, doncs que us feu socis. Té un cost molt elevat, que és el de 40 euros l'any. Si són estudiants, només són 20 durant 3 anys, després passen els membres de ple dret, amb 40 euros. Crec que és una quota, diguem-ne, francament assequible, i així teniu més ocasió doncs, de rebre les nostres comunicacions, però sobretot de participar d'aquesta idea, d'aquest objectiu, de promoure i divulgar. No fem divulgar la recerca en ciència econòmica, no fem recerca dins de la societat. Creiem que per això ja hi ha els instituts, per exemple, l'ICREA, exacte, hi ha molts altres instituts d'investigacions econòmiques, instituts d'estudis econòmics, gabinets d'estudis, de bancs, per exemple el gabinet de CaixaBank, etc. Però nosaltres no volem fer la competència, volem simplement que el que fan aquests és, i sobretot per economistes de les nostres terres, de les terres del nostre patrimoni lingüístic i cultural comú, doncs que es pugui divulgar, perquè si es divulga la recerca, si es queda dins d'un àmbit estrictament acadèmic, està molt bé, però convé que desbordi una mica l'àmbit acadèmic i sense arribar al gran públic, perquè llavors potser pot ser objecte de malentesos, però sí que en els que són economistes, que n'hi ha molts més, encara que no facin recerca, que coneguin que la ciència econòmica està evolucionant positivament i està creant un cos de doctrina important que pot servir sobretot per el que ha de servir la ciència econòmica, per plantejar millor el futur i resoldre amb recursos escassos millor les necessitats de les persones, sobretot els que són més joves que nosaltres, de les generacions futures. I parlo de les generacions futures perquè considero, des del meu punt de vista evident, en el professor Giorgos Kallis com una generació ja de present, que mentre que jo ja estic una mica a la retirada. I ho dic perquè, i ara parlaré ja en anglès, disculpeu-me si el meu no és d'Oxford, però ho intento parlar l'anglès el millor possible, Dr. Callis was born in Athens in 1972. So he is only 43, 44 years old. But even if he is very young, he has a long CV. This biography is very important, and there his contributions to the economic science and mainly to the ecological economics is very large. He, for example, I could say, according to the biography I have got, that he has more or less four, the academic background has four important diplomas, let us say. First, I could say, a Marie Curie International Fellow at the Energy and Resources Group of the University of California at Berkeley. This is one. Second, a philosophy doctor in environment policy and planning from the University of the Aegean in Greece. He was born in Greece, so it's logic that he could have a philosophy doctor there in the University of the Aegean in Greece. A master's in economics from the University Pompeu Fabra, and also a master's in environmental engineering and a bachelor's final in chemistry from Imperial College in London. So, as you see, he has received influence in many different countries, United States, England, Greece, and Catalonia. His research on ecological economics form part of the international interdisciplinary field of environmental studies, that is, what is the environmental studies? The study of the social and biophysical causes of environmental degradation. He cooperated, in fact, with Dr. Professor Norgaard in Berkeley, where they advanced the concept of socio-ecological coevolution. He will explain, I am sure about this. And now he is exploring the hypothesis of sustainable, what we see here, degrowth. Not the growth, but the sustainable degrowth. This is a smooth economic downscaling to a sustainable future where we can live better with less. This is the concept that he has and he wants to develop, and I think we are all interested in hearing him. Thank you, Dr. Callis, for coming. Your contribution, I am sure, you know that it will be registered. You will have the possibility of seeing it again in some days, not tomorrow, but in very few days you will have the possibility of seeing it in the videoteca of the Institute. Thank you for coming. Please start.
Thank you very much for your invitation, and thank you particularly to Professor Beneria, who invited me to the Critical Economics series. And the field of thought within economics, or I would say within interdisciplinary environmental studies, that I want to present today is called ecological economics. So it's one among the many different strands of heterodox or critical economics. We have feminist economics, have biophysical economics, we have environmental economics is not part of this. We have political economy, we have institutional economics. So what I want to focus today is mostly on ecological economics, which is the area where I'm trained. And it's interestingly, it's a field that was developed by ecologists and economists coming together at the beginning of the 1980s. In a sense, economists who were dissatisfied with the way their discipline was treating environmental problems, and ecologists who were feeling that in order to understand better environmental problems, they have to collaborate also with social scientists and economists. This was the basic philosophy behind ecological economics. Interestingly enough, the International Society for Ecological Economics was founded here in Barcelona in 1987, hosted the first meeting of the society by Professor Martínez Allier, who is here today. And since then, there has been a strong school of ecological economics here in Barcelona and in our institute at ICTA in Barcelona. And I am one of the people there, but I'm not alone. Many other ecological economists over the years have passed, worked, and published through our institute, ICTA, which is an institute not of economics, but of interdisciplinary environmental studies. So we have both ecologists, conservation scientists, climatologists, and economists and social scientists coming together. So I want to explain a little bit what is ecological economics, and first I have to make a distinction that for some people is not always clear, but ecological economics is not environmental economics. So environmental economics, I would simply define it as the application of mainstream economics, neoclassical economics, on the questions of the environment. Basically, and oversimplifying, treating environmental problems as a case of an externality that hasn't been internalized by the market, and then searching for a range of tools from cost-benefit analysis to proper pricing, carbon pricing, etc., for internalizing this damage within the environment, internalizing this damage of the environment within the market. Okay, that's environmental economics, and that's not what I'm talking about today. So what I'm talking about is ecological economics, which is quite different. So what are the principles of ecological economics? Mainstream economics and environmental economics starts basically with a graph that you all know, that it's the firms and the consumers, and the firms pay to hire people, and then people consume and pay the firms to buy products. No? It's a very different starting point for ecological economics. Ecological economics starts from a view of the economy as a metabolic system. What does this mean? Each one of our bodies has a metabolism, no? We take energy, we take materials, we produce waste, we move around and we consume energy, we consume calories. Imagine all our bodies summed up, no? At the total of the society, and on top of that, all the instruments that we use, all the infrastructures, etc. This has a metabolism, an energy and raw materials that are going in the economy, and a waste and heat and matter that goes out of the economy. So ecological economics starts from the premise, or from the point of view, that the economy can be analyzed and seen and treated as an ecosystem, or as part of the ecosystem, which, as you understand, it's a very different starting point from that of standard economics. The most important and milestone work in ecological economics was the book by Nicholas Georgescu-Rogan, who was an economist, but also a physicist by training and mathematician, statistician. His book was called The Entropy Law and the Economic Process, where he basically argued that the economy is a process that it's entropic, takes low entropy, well-ordered energy or matter, and transforms it through a process of producing useful things into high entropy and low-ordered, less concentrated forms of energy. I think the debate around the contribution of Nicholas Georgescu-Rogan took a kind of trivial and, I would say, unproductive direction, which was whether there are ultimately limits to growth or the economy because of entropy. So this was okay, yes, maybe after a billion years, etc., the sun will run out, or the energy in the planet is going to run out and there's going to be total entropy and then nothing else. But I think that's a way to trivialize the contribution of Georgescu-Rogan, which was much more interesting and much more important, especially in his book. So one important distinction that he made in his work about entropy was the distinction between stocks of energy and flows of energy. So we can understand solar energy as a flow of energy, and we can understand fossil fuels as a stock of energy. The stock of energy is a concentrated form of energy with low entropy, high order. You take out, you use it, and then you produce carbon emissions, which is impossible to recycle after. So then you have a very high entropy resource that it's heat, practically lost forever. Okay, so that was the main insight of Georgescu-Rogan, using physics to explain that the resources that we are using, we are losing them forever. It's not that we are using capital in a way that it's sustainable. But then he also made a very interesting insight, which was that the other source of energy, which is solar energy, which is a flow, is much more, less concentrated than fossil fuels, no? So in order to capture this diffuse form of energy, which has a high entropy, higher entropy resource, you have to use other materials, you have to use more land. What we later found when we tried to develop, for example, solar energy at high scale, and we saw, of course, that this takes a lot of land and creates other type of problems, or uses a lot of materials. So yes, there are other sources of energy, but they use other energy and other materials in order to concentrate them, because they have a higher entropy to start with. Another key contribution of ecological economists was precisely to think of energy not in absolute terms, but I think in terms of net energy terms. What does this mean? It means that in order to get energy, you have to spend energy to get it. In order to get oil out of the soil, you have to spend energy to extract it, to dig it, no? To pay the bulldozers, to get the geological engineers moving. All this also consumes energy. The same, if you want to build a nuclear power plant, you have to spend energy to build it, then to treat the waste, then to move the waste around, etc. So one key contribution of ecological economics, and of Howard and Doom in particular, was to put the emphasis on how much net energy are we getting out of energy resources. And to argue that this net energy that we drew, especially from fossil fuels at the beginning of capitalism and industrial revolution, was crucial for the type of gains in labor productivity that we saw, because we got a huge surplus of net energy from this stored low entropy fossil fuels under the ground. Okay. Another argument that ecological economists, I have three more arguments to go, I might tell you here, but I need this theoretical framework in order then to make sense what I'm going to say about the growth, because if what I'm going to say I said it within the mainstream framework, then of course there would be much more objections, but this is the framework within which I will position my argument about the growth. Another key argument by ecological economists is that services, which on the surface they might seem as not using too much energy, they embody a lot of energy. In order to have services, in order to produce services, you embody a hierarchy of a lot of energy. I mean, you need food to produce to feed the service workers. You need material in order to make the computers that provide the services work. It's the same as an ecosystem hierarchy, or where you have like a fish at the top of the ecosystem scale. Below you have the phytoplankton. The phytoplankton is taking sun, and you go down, and at the top of the food scale you have the fish that embodies a lot of energy that it has taken below. In the same analogy, think of the services, the service worker embodying a huge pyramid of energy below. So it might seem dematerialized at the top of the pyramid, but it embodies a lot of energy to make possible this worker to be a service worker at the top of the pyramid. Unlike environmental economics, where externalities are thought as something that it's outside of the market, assuming that it's something that can be internalized by the market, so we can have pricing instruments or markets and internalize carbon emissions, their damage, no? Ecological economics starts from a very different premise, which is that externalities are ever-present, they are ubiquitous, they are unavoidable, and in a sense, they are cost-shifting successes, as William Kapp, a proto-ecological institutional economist, called them. Just to give an example for that, I read recently a book by Raj Patel, which is called The Value of Everything, and he makes this interesting example. He says, like, take a McDonald's hamburger, you know? If you were trying to internalize all the damage that it's being caused to produce a McDonald's hamburger, it would cost $150. He makes a rough calculation like that. Obviously, a McDonald's hamburger cannot cost $150 because it would never sell. So in order for this product to be profitable and be able to be sold around, you have an externalization, a process of shifting the costs of producing a McDonald's to people that they are not compensated, of course, for the damage they receive. And this makes the McDonald's at the end cost $1 and not $150. Finally, I would say that the key difference of ecological economics is that rather than thinking in terms of one value, in theoretical terms utility, or in practical terms money, which is then used to make cost-benefit assessments and compare one possible option like cut a forest or leave a forest, no? And then you do a cost-benefit assessment in terms of money. In ecological economics, we say that there are different values and that these different values are not necessarily commensurable. So a forest has a value in terms of its sanctity, in terms of its pleasure that it gives to people, in terms of its history, in terms of its culture, also in terms of the revenue it produces for tourism or for logging, but also in terms of intrinsic values to provide to ecosystems that we cannot count them. So all these are different values, that they are incommensurable on the one hand, but on the other hand, they can be compared. So John Martinez Ali and John O'Neill wrote a very interesting paper, which was exactly arguing about the weak comparability of these values. So we have a culturally sacred forest and a forest that produces logging. It's not a market that is going to resolve what to do, but there are institutions that can compare these values and mediate them and find a medium solution. With this in mind, let me just jump straight ahead with a graph. I'm going to use, because I'm talking to an economist audience today, I'm going to use a lot of graphs today. I hope I won't tire the rest of you. but they are simple graphs. So that's the simplest graph that it gets about environmental damage. So this is carbon emissions and global GDP. And of course, what you see is a one-to-one relationship, almost parallel, the one following the other. The only times that we had the global reductions in carbon emissions were during the main recessions, where Soviet Union collapsed, etc. I mean, the link between the economy, the scale of the economy and carbon emissions at the global level is as close to a statistically significant relationship as it gets in economics. And that's not just for carbon emissions, it's for any type of environmental damage, material flows, etc., at the global scale. Why I insist on the global scale? Because at the local scale or at the national scale, you have distortions because of trade. So you might have a stabilization of carbon emissions in Spain, but this is because industrial products that emit emissions are imported from China. So then you have accounting problems. But if you take it at the global scale, you find this very strong one-to-one relationship. The economy, we know from ecological economics, is fundamentally material and fundamentally produces waste. So for an ecological economist, this is not a surprise. Of course, in the Paris Convention and in the dominant discourse, the idea is that we can separate these two lines, the so-called decoupling or dematerialization or decarbonization. The idea is that you can have global GDP, the red line, keep going up, and the blue line suddenly go down, and you have an X, no? And I like to joke with that, and I say, like, okay, yes, this might be theoretically possible, I cannot prove it wrong, but if that was the case, then there is no basis for anything in economics to talk about some empirical regularity, because you might argue, yes, in the past there was empirical regularity, in the future we're going to separate them and it's going to not be anymore. And on this type of discourse, yes, we can talk forever that maybe it's possible or maybe it's not possible. But what I want to emphasize here is that the data shows that it's at least, at the minimum, to say, very, very hard to separate these two. And if you do, like, for those of you who are econometricians, you do panel data analysis and you take many countries, carbon emissions, different factors, renewable energies, regulation, oil prices, and you put inside also contraction or not of the economy, you find that the single factor that most accurately, strongly, and decisively predicts a decrease in carbon emissions is a contraction in the economy. And there is no dispute of this fact. So then we might argue that we hope we can have growth, not we, I mean, I don't hope, but there are people who hope that we can have growth and reduce carbon emissions, and it's good to have hopes. But are these hopes realistic? I would say they are not. So this brings me to the degrowth hypothesis, which I'm going to elaborate. 3 points. Green dematerialized growth is implausible. What I just said now, but I'm going to put a little bit more beef on the bone, as they say, of what I just argued. So the idea of green growth, of continuing to having growth and at the same time at the global level improving environmental conditions, I call it implausible because I don't want to call it impossible, and I haven't found the equation to prove that it's impossible, but I think it's implausible. The second part, I'm going to argue that growth has become uneconomic in what Herman Daly calls the overdeveloped world, and he calls the global north, Herman Daly calls it overdeveloped in the sense that we use much more than our fair share of resources of the planet, and that growth in this part of the world, in our part of the world, is no longer even deriving some benefits that it derives at lower levels of development. And then, more controversial and more difficult, I'm going to provide some insights that it is possible to prosper without growth or with growth. Or I might say it is plausible again, rather than possible, because possibility is different. But I say it's quite plausible. This material comes from a book we published last year with my co-editors here, Giacomo D'Alessio and Federico De Maria, who are sitting in the audience. It's a book with, it's an edited volume with 50 chapters, translated in 10 languages, including Catalan. My presentation today is very partial because degrowth is a much broader and interdisciplinary discourse. So it brings together feminist economists, economic anthropologists. We talk about the economy of care, we talk about the commons. We have people who come from political philosophy and the uncritical of ideas of development. I'm not going to touch any of this today because today I want to focus a little bit on a more economic or economistic, you might call it, discourse that it's coming out of this book, and it's only one part of the streams that it's forming these debates. So for those of you who are economists, I might be less than an economist than you would have liked. For those of you who are more, let's say, from the degrowth world, you might think I'm more economist than you would have liked. liked, but that's the fate of being interdisciplinary, so we're somewhere in between and trying to combine different fields. So the three arguments are going. I'm going to present them in terms of three groups of slides with graphs. So the first three graphs are going to be about the first argument and so on. Okay, so let me start with the first three visuals. The first ones are an argument against green growth. So, I mean, the debate about limits to growth is very old. Some of you might say it's, I read somewhere someone said it's Groundhog Day or a deja vu. For those of you who lived it in the 70s, it was a, I hear, much more lively debate even than it's now.
Meadows.
Meadows, yes. And then Solow, who supposedly demolished Meadows, but didn't demolish it. At least for us ecological economists, he didn't demolish it, but that's what he claims. Or Paul Krugman claims today that his teacher demolished Meadows. He didn't demolish them, but he provided some arguments which I think are sound, but I think they don't hold. So one of the first arguments that Solow presented against the idea of Meadows that there are limits to growth, he said, yes, there might be limits and we might be the economy using, as its scale grows, would be consuming more and more materials and emit more and more carbon emissions. But he says, this loses the part that with technological progress, we become more and more efficient. So we might consume less resources per unit of GDP. So this might more than compensate the increase in the scale of the economy, and the overall use of resources or of emissions go down because we become much, much more efficient. So if you think a car today emits much less carbon than a car 30 years ago emitted, it's much more efficient per unit of whatever product it delivers. This makes sense, but then what doesn't make sense from this perspective is this picture here, which is quite characteristic. The red line is China. It's more or less the same pattern also for the US, but less pronounced. But for China, you can see it very clearly. So you see for China, the strong line is the efficiency of the economy or the carbon intensity. So in one sense is the how much carbon, the red line, the strong line is total carbon emissions for China, no? That you see it going up as you would expect. The other line, the broken line, is the efficiency of the Chinese economy in terms of carbon. So how much carbon it uses for a unit of GDP product. And this goes down. So the Chinese economy becomes much, much more efficient as it technologically advances, as Solow predicted. But its carbon emissions go up in the skies. Why does this happen? You might argue that it's for a low adoption of technologies, etc. No. An ecological economist would propose here a more structural relationship between efficiency and scale, that these are not just independent variables. Our starting point is what we call Jevons paradox, from Stanley Jevons, who wrote in The Coal Question back in the 19th century. It was the beginning when the steam engine was invented, no? The steam engine was using coal. And Jevons noted the obvious fact that the steam engine was much more efficient in terms of how much coal it was using, but as a result, we started using much more and more coal. Why was that? Because the more efficient steam engine reduced the prices of coal, and then many new users for coal emerged, and they started pumping more and more coal. So we started using, as we were becoming more efficient, we were using more resources. And there is a causal relationship between these two. It's not an accidental relationship. There's nothing surprising there. What surprises me that economists very often make a distinction. So when it comes to labor productivity, no economist would argue that by becoming more labor productive, the amount of labor, the amount of workers we need goes down. No, the idea is, yes, we can employ more and more workers because the economy grows also as a result of labor productivity. It's exactly the same thing with energy productivity or energy efficiency. The more efficient and productive an economy becomes, the more it increases and the more energy resources it uses. That's precisely what growth is about becoming more productive, getting surpluses, investing them and growing more. So here there is a fundamental link between efficiency and growth of carbon emissions, of any other type of material resource use or damage, that it's not easy to just say, put the numbers that say, yes, if we become 10 times more efficient and the economy grows only 2 times, then we're going to use 5 times less resources. No, it's not like that. If we become 10 times more efficient, probably we're going to grow also 15 times, okay? The second argument is against the idea that the economy somehow can dematerialize You might hear a lot about the weightless economy, the dematerialized economy, especially people who come from the Silicon Valley or from work on Facebook, etc. They think that because they think they are dematerialized and because they produce a lot of money, they think that this can be generalized to the economy as a whole. So you say, okay, if me on my keyboard, I produce 1 billion worth of stock, if you are, what's the name, the guy of Facebook now, or Sergey Brin of Google, you think that this can be generalized everywhere. But that's not, I mean, obviously that doesn't have any economic or, let's say, theoretical foundation to claim that. Where is wealth being produced? There was a debate recently that, for example, in the OECD and the more developed economies, our material use was coming to a peak. So some people talked about peak consumption. They said, we use less materials, we've used the cars that we wanted, we've done that, and now we use more immaterial services. So now we enjoy more using our WhatsApps and sending stupid messages to one another. No? And there was some evidence to support this. The evidence was that if you see domestic material consumption, which is the red line, domestic material consumption is the total amount of materials domestically extracted or imported into a country, okay? So it's the amount of copper, silver, iron, all the materials, gravel that Spain or Catalonia extracts in here or imports from China or from other parts of the world in order to produce, okay? And for most OECD countries, you would see a kind of plateauing of this while GDP increases. So people said, okay, there is peak material consumption, we are dematerializing, we are becoming service economies. But then come people that very reasonably said, yes, but what about materials that we are not using directly to produce in Spain or in Catalonia, but we are importing because people produce the products we used to be producing, they produce them now in China, and we import them here so that we can be service workers. How do we account for that? And the clever way to account for that was the indicator of material footprint. So what you do is you take all the products consumed within the borders of Catalonia, and then you say how much materials were used to produce this product that we consumed in Catalonia. This is called the material footprint of the economy of Catalonia. You calculate this in this way, and then what you find is again the same straight line that I talked about before. Almost one-to-one relationship between the material footprint of OECD countries, the supposedly dematerializing more advanced economies, and their scale of the economy of their GDP. So no dematerialization yet. I like to claim, like to call it a paradox. Why would I call it a paradox? Because all economists were predicting that this should and would happen. So I would say, okay, why is it not happening then? Why is no one trying to explain that in any other way than the one we are explaining as ecological economists, which is a rough cut way that the economy is material? Of course, this cannot be proven. People can tell you, no, the economy is not just material, it's also information, it's communication. Okay, then if it's information and communication, we've been through the most important information and communication revolution of all times. 80% of our economies are services. How is it then that they are so materially intensive still? Why haven't they dematerialized after all this fundamental economic transformation that has taken place the last 30 years? Of course, someone might argue that certain products or certain materials or certain forms of producing energy can be substituted for less damaging ones. So you might argue, and I think it's a reasonable argument to say, that yes, we could shift from fossil fuel producing energy technologies to renewable technologies. And that's just a shift, it's a substitution. There is no a priori reason why this would be impossible, no? And I agree that it is possible to shift from fossil fuels to renewable. Where I would put a question mark, though, is whether with such a shift from fossil fuel energies to renewable energies, we would be able to maintain the current scale of the economy, the global economy, or if you want, the OECD economy, and the current patterns of expected rates of growth, which are 2 or 3% per year, which means a doubling of the economy every 25 to 35 years. And why would I put a question mark there? I would put a question mark. I mean, there are people like Paul Krugman who are saying the following. They are saying we can both have a transition to renewable energies and also stimulate the economy to grow, no? Like we spend money with the Green New Deal on infrastructures, on highways, on trains, or even worse, and the economy started growing again, we can do the same now by investing on renewable energies. And this might make sense in the short term. Yes, if you have a lack of demand, etc., yes, it's good to have public investments on this type of activities. But can this produce the type of growth that was produced in the 1930s or 40s or 50s on the back of an incredible and unique and unprecedented source of net energy, which were fossil fuels? So there are people, by economists like Charles Hall, who have tried to calculate how much net energy, or EROI as they call it, energy return on energy investment, different type of energy sources produce. So how much energy do you come out for each unit of energy you put to take out a source of energy, okay? And they found, this is an old graph, but more or less their estimations haven't changed. It's a 2010 paper, but the graph is still from 1986, but the picture is the same. So they say, like, for oil in the 1930s, you would put one unit of energy in and you would take 100 units of energy out. For oil in the 1990s, you get 20 units of oil out, much less net energy out. And if you see renewables, they are much less than that. They are in the order of 5 to 10, at the best case scenario, 15 or 20 with technological progress. So the question mark here is, for an ecological economist who thinks that net energy matters for the scale of economic growth, a mainstream economist, energy doesn't enter even in the production function, so it wouldn't make such a big difference. But from an ecological economics perspective, we say labor productivity, on its very basis, it is also because of the use of oil. Oil did a lot of work. Like, think of energy slaves, no? If you had to put people to carry elevators up, this would use a lot of people, you know? We are much more labor productive because there is petroleum and electricity pulling the elevator up. So the question is, if we go to energy sources that they use, they have much less net energy, would we be able to maintain the same scale of the economy, the same growth rates? The answer from a degrowth perspective is no. It's very unlikely. It seems unlikely. It hasn't been proven, but it seems unlikely, and I think at least it merits more research. Growth has become uneconomic. Two slides on this one. So these are pretty standard slides, and they won't be as a surprise to you, but there are two ways to measure welfare independently of GDP now. The first one is to measure it objectively, as much objectively as you can, and Herman Daly and others have developed the Index for Sustainable Economic Welfare. In San Francisco, there is the Genuine Progress think tank, which has developed the Genuine Progress Indicator, where you try to put different indicators and different values, non-commensurable values, together, instead of having just one single factor, which is GDP, and you try to evaluate welfare objectively, independently of GDP now. This figure is for Finland, but the same picture emerges for many other advanced economies. So what you see is that after the 1980s, you have GDP increasing and sustainable economic welfare or progress indicators going down, staying the same or going down. So I have some people who have told me, that doesn't prove that growth doesn't work. It proves that neoliberalism and the turn with Thatcher and Reagan went things for the worse. And there is also the evidence that wage stagnated after this period. So while GDP went up, the median wage stagnated. So yes, this is a question mark. Is this stagnation and fall of progress or welfare or however we define it because also wages stagnated because of redistribution to the 1%? Or is it also because above certain levels of growth, you cannot maintain the same level also of increasing of other wealth, of the rest of the welfare? Herman Daly argues the latter. He says with more and more growth, you have more and more environmental damages, more and more social costs. So at some point, he argues, growth becomes uneconomic. So it's no longer economic growth, it's uneconomic growth. Now, you might also measure the welfare effects subjectively. You might measure it by asking people how happy they are. Now, there is two camps there in the literature. I don't want to go in detail. There are people who are saying that over time, although the income increases in a country, the number of people who report themselves very happy stays the same. And there are good reasons for that. First of all, our preferences adapt to what we have. Imagine the first person who flew with an airplane and us now flying and getting bored. You know, there's no excitement at all with flying with an airplane. But we adjust to what we have. That's one reason. The other reason is that many times our satisfaction with our life is also comparable. How well do we do compared to how well others are doing? And if a society becomes more unequal and more positional, then people, even if the economy grows, people become less or the same happy, so it doesn't make a difference. So now there is a different camp, of course, that uses different indicators, different types of samples and statistical analysis, and claims that happiness does increase with growth. So I don't want to go into the details, but I want to point also to these two question marks again, that growth doesn't necessarily go together with welfare. And actually, what the econometrics of happiness are showing is that other features, such as social capital, employment, equality, correlate for sure and much stronger with subjective well-being and with happiness, self-reported happiness of people. And this, I would say, makes sense. I mean, the more an economy grows and grows and grows, we would expect, theoretically saying too, that the returns to happiness or to well-being or to welfare, they would be marginal. I mean, once you get from you cannot meet your basic needs to meeting them, this is a huge improvement on your welfare. Once you get from iPhone 3 to iPhone 4, probably it's not as big of a change. This graph is from a recent paper, not so recent, 4 years, but time passes quickly, on nature climate change from Julia Steinberger and colleagues. What they showed was, again, with some basic statistical analysis, that you can have sustainable levels of development. So basically, this plots life expectancy, or you can plot other indicators of human development against carbon emissions. So what it shows is that there is a window within which you can have countries that have good levels of development, human development, in terms of life expectancy, for example, life expectancy in the range of 80 years old average, which is also what OECD or richer countries have, at very low and sustainable levels of carbon emissions. Okay, the color makes it three-dimensional, this graph. So the color shows the income of countries. So what you see is that you have high-income countries, which do not have distinctively much better results in terms of human development, but they have extraordinarily much more carbon emissions. So this again reframes a little bit the idea of development, where development is always to reach the first one, the one who is in front. Supposedly it's always to reach the type of pathways the US or economies like the US are opening. No, this graph here is arguing that there might be pathways that they are both in a way improving human development and also sustainable carbon-wise. But they are not the models of the US or the wealthier countries. They are models that we have to search more within the medium range of incomes. Now, the countries that I see there are not all of them great examples to look at. So I see Albania there, I see Sri Lanka, you know, I see Nicaragua. So I see countries that they have problematic regimes, problematic histories, problematic conditions. So that's not a simplistic argument to say they have found some secret. But what, again, I'm trying to do is to unsettle a bit. But we have also countries like Costa Rica, Uruguay. I mean, countries that you might argue that they have managed to combine a sufficient level of well-being with a low level of environmental impact. So why don't we call them the developed countries and try to see what they are doing and try to reach them? So it is possible to prosper without growth. Here I have a few slides too. I'm in 35 minutes, so I think I should conclude by 50 minutes. I'll have 15 minutes more for three slides plus a broader conclusion.
Use the time you need.
Yes, okay, thanks. Now I would like to have some discussion for you. So one of the key concerns is that within a capitalist economy, when you don't have growth, you have all sorts of problems. And of course, no one can be oblivious to that. If we were saying that we are oblivious to that fact and we are saying that the recession or contraction is good, we would be completely naive. So no one who is arguing for the growth is arguing for that. The argument for the growth is like, let's first agree that there is a strong case to make that the economy cannot sustainably continue to grow, ecologically sustainably cannot continue to grow like that, and then let's discuss what are the alternatives. And then let's open up the range of the alternatives. For sure, I mean, I am from Greece and I know that recession has a very ugly face, a terrible face, a catastrophic circumstances face. But is it necessarily so? Is it necessarily that under all type of institutional conditions, under all type of politics, under all type of international agreements, you have this result when you have when you have a recession or a contraction of the economy? Again, I would put a question mark. I don't think there is a necessary condition. And the range of changes you might have from one type of capitalist free market economy to a kind of social democracy or socialist type of economy, there is a huge range of institutional alternatives that may create very different outcomes in a period of recession. This is just a simple graph to show that. And it's from a paper of the IMF that was not arguing anything like that. It was arguing that Okun's law holds. So Okun's law, you might know, is the relationship between employment and unemployment, employment and growth. So 1% growth leads to 1% increase in employment rate. This would be a one-to-one relationship. So what this graph shows is the effect of a 1% change in output on the unemployment rate for different countries. So what you see is that, unfortunately, you live in a country where it's the only country where a 1% decrease in the growth rate means 1% increase in the unemployment rate. Or if you want a 10% decrease in the growth rate, means a 10 percentage points increase in the unemployment rate. But then you go to the other extreme and you see a country like Japan or Austria, and then you see that it takes 10 points of a decrease in GDP for 1 point increase in unemployment. So a huge variety of relationship between contraction and unemployment. What does this mean? I mean, I'm not sure what it means. What I'm perplexed with is that the IMF report doesn't focus at all at this point and is not interested to answer this question. Would it be possible to have high employment without economic growth or with economic contraction? They don't ask this question. I mean, the interesting question would be for me, what is different in Japan? Why Japan has had 20 years now of basically no growth and still the unemployment rate is at 3 to 4%? I'm asking Japanese friends over dinner or over lunch, but that's not serious research. But you might hear about the way Japanese companies treat workers, you might hear about the labor regulations, you might hear about the support social safety net that exists there, etc. I'm not saying that Japan is doing something miraculous, but I'm saying there are important institutional differences, not least in terms of the labor regulation and labor market regulation, that might make a huge difference on the relationship between growth and unemployment. Within ecological economics and within those that study degrowth, that's a key question. So Tim Jackson, who wrote a very interesting book, also translated here by Ikaria, called Prosperity Without Growth, he argued that if we don't have growth, a way of reducing unemployment would be to share work, reduce the working hours. That's an old argument. The counter argument by economists is that this would increase the cost of labor and would eat on the benefits of employment by sharing work. But I did a literature review of this line of research with Nicholas Ashford, who is an environmental policy scholar at the MIT. And what we found is that there is a much more, again, complicated relationship, which depends on the institutional conditions, etc. But in most cases, reducing working hours, yes, creates more employment. That's actually how the United States in the 30s created more employment in the period of the New Deal without growth, by reducing the working hours, without reducing the wage, interestingly, you know, or at least without directly decreasing it. Other ecological economists are talking about the idea of a basic income, a minimum guaranteed income to everyone as a percentage of GDP. There are people here in Catalonia doing very interesting studies where they try to quantify what sort of basic income would be sustainable to be paid by the public revenue and by the tax system without a major overhaul of the tax system. There, the idea is not to create employment, but to make sure that if our economy creates more and more unemployment, and there are some benefits that this may happen in the future because of increasing labor productivity. I'm critical of that because of the energy factor. But in any case, if there is more and more unemployment, even because of energy or because of increasing labor productivity, that at least out of the common pool, we create a minimum safety net for everyone with a basic income. So kind of rethinking and reinventing the welfare state. A strong argument against the idea that the economy can be downscaled or can contract and this not cause huge problem is the notion, and this came very strong in the book by Thomas Piketty, that in periods of low growth we have a skyrocketing inequalities. So Piketty argued that the only period where we had very low inequality, and this is, as you see here, this is income inequality, but you can have capital or wealth inequality, etc. This is from the 1940s to the 1980s for the US. It was a period of very high growth. So it was a period of unprecedented growth of 4 to 5%. Piketty gave a rule of thumb that he said, how much inequality you have depends on part on how much the growth rate compares to the rate of return to capital. So if the rate of return to capital is 3% and the growth rate is 5%, less and less of the total product goes to the capitalists, the ones who have capital in their hands. But if you have 3% return to capital and 0% growth rate, this means that more and more money accumulates in the hands of those who already hold capital, and you have increasing inequalities. This might make sense, but then if you start unpacking this argument, it becomes problematic. For example, how can you have always 3% return on capital if you don't have any growth? No, at some point, this would have to reach a limit. Piketty uses some historical data. He says, look, 19th century France, I read some novels, people were having 5% return on their estates, and their economies were stagnant, so this can happen. Probably it can happen, but what's the economic logic behind it? Daron Acemoglu, who is one of the most famous neoclassical mainstream economists now, did a basic econometric test, and he didn't find any correlation between this difference between R and G and inequalities, and the level of inequality. And we do know that inequalities increase even with growth, in countries with growth. So we know that within countries, growth, especially the last 30 years, has come with an increase of inequalities. So the period also of 90 to 2000, at some points, the US had quite high growth rates. But this didn't mean that inequalities didn't increase. And of course, the second reading one can do of Piketty is that what matters is not so much growth, but the institutional and political conditions. Again, it's the institutions of how you tax wealth and how you tax income that make the difference for inequalities. So from 1940s to 1980s, you have an extraordinary for our levels, but not for the for that period, the rates of taxation on highest income, almost to 95%. When we read it now, we don't believe it, you know, now the rates are 30%. But the rates started going to 30% in the 80s. I mean, this is quite a recent development. So there was a very different institutional setup that secured inequality there. And this didn't have to do with growth or lack of growth. It had to do with political determination. It had to do with a very strong labor movement and trade unions at the time. It had to do, you might argue, with the Cold War, and that the Americans were afraid that if they didn't give enough to labor, then the Russians would win their hearts. So they would give and they would tax more. And the rich maybe were even more willing to be taxed because they knew that there was a danger. So there are all these factors that determine the level of inequality rather than growth per se. And if you see the huge slump in inequality rates there, the inconvenient truth, as you might call it, that this shows is that it was war that redistributed. So it was a total destruction, the worst destruction that we've ever faced, that redistributed wealth. Piketty doesn't reach this conclusion because it's a very dim one, but it is a dim conclusion that the capitalist system doesn't reproduce automatically apart from distractions. And that's a scary conclusion, but that's one that you cannot avoid looking at the data there. It's 1941 if you see that inequalities go down. And there was no growth also in this period. So one last point. First of all, if we want to break this idea that growth is at all costs necessarily for prosperity, first of all, we have to see that growth is a quite recent phenomenon. As a concept, it was basically invented in the 50s, believe it or not. So economists, of course, would be concerned with the wealth of nations, etc., Adam Smith, but they wouldn't talk about growth per se. So growth is a concept that appears mostly in the 50s with Keynesianism and with Kuznets, the measuring of GDP, etc. Before, we wouldn't talk about growth. But growth also as a material phenomenon is a quite recent phenomenon. It starts at the global level in the mid-19th century with industrial revolution and with capitalism. So it's a phenomenon that goes hand in hand with capitalism and industrial revolution. First, we have to show, are we the only societies capitalist or so-called socialist societies, industrial societies, are the only ones that have prospered in human history? I would say no. I come from Greece, and we are trained from early age at school that our ancestors were quite prosperous. And growth didn't exist as a concept. They weren't measuring how their economy was doing. We don't know if it was growing or not. It was quite prosperous. Actually, more people were living in the islands at that time than they live now. So the economy was organized in a way that was providing for the people, was prosperous, was not necessarily growing, and it was definitely hundreds of times smaller than the current economy. So it's not the only time that we've had prosperity. It's definitely the only time that we've had sustained growth at that level, growth both of population and of economic output. But is this growth sustainable? And I wouldn't put here just the ecological dimension, because the ecological dimension, I think we can argue forever whether and when limits to growth will appear from the ecology side. But I think climate change actually is a very strong factor that we cannot overlook now. But the limits to growth report in the 1970s, I think, made a different point that has been kind of overlooked. They made the point that any type of geometric growth on the long term is unsustainable. And this is mathematically unsustainable. I mean, if you have something that grows at 3% a year, which is the healthy rate of growth, it means it doubles every 25 years, 70 divided by 3, more or less, okay? So this doubles, doubles, and doubles. So from 1, it becomes 2, it becomes 4, it becomes 8. The limits to growth report starts with these examples. It says, imagine, you know, when you have a lake and the plankton doubles every 10 years or 20, suddenly at some point you have half of the lake only filled up. But then the next year, suddenly, the next doubling, the whole lake is gone. So these doublings are bigger and bigger, and they are harder and harder to be sustained. For ecological reasons, or as Marxist political economists like David Harvey argue, for the difficulty of finding also investment outlets and creating new demands for this ever-growing economy, like doubling every 25 years on an already large size, to create more demand, more investments, create new infrastructures. That gets harder and harder and more difficult. We were, ecological economists, the only ones to talk about stagnation, but as people say, you know, we predicted all 30 of the last two periods of stagnation, you know, so we overpredict stagnation. But at least we are the only ones who talked and predicted the stagnations. Now, the discussion about secular stagnation is mainstream. So you have Lawrence Summers talking about secular stagnation, you have Paul Krugman talking about stagnation, you have new books like Robert Gordon saying that the era of growth is over. And of course, you have Piketty, who says the same. He says in the next 100 years, growth rates at the best are going to be 0 to 1%, as they've been for most of human history. They were 3 to 4% only in the period after the worst catastrophe we've ever had, which was the Second World War. So save for that, growth is there. It's 0 to 1%. So stagnation is coming anyways. The question is, what next? What happens there? And Piketty's book was opening this debate in a sense. It's like, are we going to have a return to a feudal, neo-patrimonial type of society, or can we create something that it's equal, or a society that it's equal within these new conditions of stagnation? So you might call me Malthusian now, and you say, Malthus was the first one who said stagnation was coming. This was 300 years ago, and he was proven wrong. First, I would say, like, okay, even if he was proven wrong 300 years ago, this doesn't mean he would be wrong forever. And even Robert Solow accepts that. He says, yes, this doesn't mean anything. If we didn't have stagnation when we first predicted it, it might always come. More interestingly, I would say, because now I'm doing some history of economic thought and I'm reading Malthus did not predict any stagnation. He was actually an advocate of growth. Okay, this might sound a little bit controversial, but this is what my new work is trying to show. But he was actually advocating growth of food in order to accommodate for growth of population. What he couldn't see was, for him, growth was just growth of population. What he couldn't see is that you can have growth in food consumption per capita. So not all growth of food go to just feed people. Some of it could go also for other things. But Malthus was someone that, if you read him closely, was zero skeptical of stagnation and zero critical of the prospects of economic growth. And it makes sense. He was actually the first professional political economist, the first one to hold the chair of political economy. It would be very strange if he was criticizing the core concept of the discipline at the time, which was the idea of the wealth of nations. So he was also concerned, as everyone, with the wealth of nations, and he believed that it can grow indefinitely and to new levels. But what I'm saying, what people who might call themselves Malthusians, but I would say they're very different from Malthus today, or environmentalists are arguing, is that even if growth were to be sustainable, and forget the Piketty or Lawrence Summers questions about secular stagnation, is that it is becoming destructive for the climate and life in the planet. And that's a whole new type of situation than the one in Malthus' time or in the one in 18th century. So we have an economic growth that is damaging. I don't care if this damage undermining the conditions for economic growth itself. We might think of an extreme scenario that this catastrophe of climate change might be good for growth, like the Second World War was good for growth. But is this something to look forward to? Is this type of human development? Is this time of an aspirational trajectory? I would argue no. And I will close with the argument that while very often it is argued that ecological economists or people who write about degrowth or the people who wrote about limits to growth are pessimists, supposedly, and those who believe that growth can continue forever and we can have new technologies and nuclear energy, for example, can be clean energy and power forever and ever a growing economy, that they are the optimists. I would say the opposite. They are the pessimists. They are the pessimists, and I would say they are the negatives, because they are the ones who cannot think out of the box of how society itself, can innovate and come together to solve collective action problems, problems like climate change, problems like environmental degradation. And I would say that the history of human progress, if you want, the history of human development has not been just one of technological progress, has been two forces. It has been technological development on the one hand, which has been very destructive, and on the other hand, we have had social progress. We have had the women's movement, we have had the labor movement, we have had people coming together and changing things, making relations and systems very different than anyone could imagine in the 18th century. If you read Malthus today, he couldn't imagine at all the type of relationships we are having, gender relationship we are having today. It's this type of innovation that I think is necessary, and it's this type of innovation that people who are critical of growth and positive about limits to growth are optimistic about our capacity to change in the face of a potential disaster. Thank you.
Ευχαριστώ. Professor Kallis, I think that you made a very good presentation. It was some phrases from you well argued, but were possibly controversial. So now we open the Q&A section, questions and answers. If you have also comments, please do it. And I am sure that Professor Kallis will be ready to answer. Thank you. Please, you have the floor. I don't know if they could put the question in Catalan or in Spanish.
Yeah, I think in Catalan I can understand. If not, I would ask you. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. So you are free to put the questions even in Catalan or in English.
Greek, yes.
But in Greek I am not able to translate, perhaps, yes. Him, but not me. Thank you.
Yes, please.
Hello, thanks for your presentation. My name is Sergio Grau. I come from RMIT Europe, and also from the University of Manchester. I've been working with Stefan Pozorowski. And I was wondering, I mean, I'm sure you haven't touched upon it much, but I guess there's a response to that in the degrowth theoretical framework. How does degrowth account for spatial and social material disparities at different scales? Mm-hmm. What happens with all those countries in the global south whose life expectancy is very low? Or something which is closer to my field of research, energy poverty, what happens to all those segments of the global population, including those here that are in energy poverty, in the sense that what's the prospect? What prospect does degrowth offer to this disadvantaged population, whose well-being levels are below what could be considered adequate?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so one, on the analytical or diagnostic part would be that this, the production of this type of disparities is an outcome of the growth economy. So it's an outcome of the accumulation process. So it's not something that's separate from that. So because you have growth here, you have the cost shifting, and you have the extraction of unequal exchange with the rest of the world, what we call a sort of ecological or carbon debt, but many other types of debts. So uneven development is not just there, but it is produced in the pursuit of growth. That would be the first argument. The second argument that I want to make is, I want to distinguish, because very often I get this argument, not the way you framed it, but the argument is we, you know, like there is the we, they, I'm going to keep it, but you understand that I'm not agreeing with this. And I would say we in the global north, or whoever is not energy poor, no, has to grow out of charity for the rest who hasn't grown, to give them the opportunity to grow, you know. And I sometimes play with this idea and I say, how come and when we were growing, we didn't need them to grow too, you know, and we were just extracting surplus resources from them and sending them waste. So again, I want to change this this framing. But of course, one cannot avoid or evade with linguistic tricks, no? The question you're putting, and which is true. I would argue that to reach a level of sufficient energy availability, or to reach a level of sufficient well-being for all the population, there are resources. There have always been resources, in a sense, for a given level of population to live in a dignified level of living. It's always the inequality that makes always that there's not enough. So I think there is, this of course is a matter of research to show, you know, but I don't think there is a necessity to produce at the global level more energy so that people who are energy poor have access to more energy. I'm not sure that it's also even necessary for their economies to grow forever at 3 or 4% or for the next 50 or 60 years in order to solve the problem of energy poverty. It's the same argument that has been made extensively about food, no? That's not a problem of lack of food, it's a problem of the way food is distributed and accessed. On the same token, I would say, yes, certain economies might need to produce more, might need to have new forms of energy or new forms of energy production, but again, up to a level. It wouldn't be the argument for a 3 or 4% growth each year. Of course, within the system that we are, this sounds theoretical. In practice, you know, we know that energy systems or water supply systems, they come together with some kind of crazy speculative boom and bonanza and 3 or 4% growth rates, and then some of it goes also to build a water system or an energy system. But is this the only alternative that we can imagine for reducing disparities? And what if this alternative starts becoming less and less possible also? So that's even...
Sending resources overseas, but how do you know that this is like the development discourse that's going on, right? But does anybody ever question that discourse? How do you know that it's not, you know, that the flow isn't in fact going the other way, that we're extracting resources and creating profit and sending it back here to Europe?
No, I'm not arguing they were sending resources overseas. Precisely, this is what I was arguing against. So I said that very often the argument is made that the OECD or the Global North should continue growing in order to help the rest of the world also grow, you know, either by creating markets or by sending development aid.
But
I'm saying that's not the case.
Just a note, does anybody really measure these transactions that go between the developing world and the...
There are people who are trying to measure them in terms of non-monetary metrics. So there is the whole literature on unequal exchange. So you have people like Alf Hornberg. I don't know if you've come across their work. Alf Hornberg, unequal exchange. So he's someone who's trying to show the flows of energy and resources that they are going between nations, rather than just the flows of monetary flows. So he's trying to show like how much our growth or our economies are based on extraction of energy and resources from the rest of the world.
Yeah, you have given an interesting lecture about the evolution of the economy peacefully. And I quite agree with your conclusions. But my question, my point is, what should be done to achieve an economy with no growth? Because it's clear that this is the goal, there is something that should be done. And the point is, what measures should be set up in order to achieve a non-growing economy or a degrowing economy? Mm-hmm. And the second point is, since I am an economist, not an environmentalist, is what should be the place, what should be the role that should play the economic tools that we have available in order to regulate the economy? For instance, prices, taxes, this kind of tools we consider that they are important in order to achieve some specific goals, because people react to different prices, people react to different taxes. So how these instruments should be used in order to achieve the goals that you have set up in your lecture?
So I didn't have time to go over that because, I mean, I have to choose where to focus. But we have published as a Research and the Growth, which is a group we have here in Barcelona of people mostly from our institute in ICTA, but also other people and scholars interested on questions of the growth. We have published a list of 10 policy proposals that we have, which is nothing, let's say, new or super extraordinary. Herman Daly, who was an ecological economist, made very similar proposals 10 or 15 years ago. So they include the ecological taxes, they include the basic income, they include a ceiling income, like a maximum income and a difference in between top and minimum salaries. They include the idea of the basic guaranteed income, of the reducing of the working hours, of putting caps on certain types of emissions, etc., legal caps, very specific legal limits on certain things. So we have a set of 10 proposals that we call them non-reformist reforms, in the sense that they look like they're just reforms, but in order to do them, especially in the current political climate and system, the whole system would have to change dramatically. So they seem easy, but they're very hard to happen, like to introduce a basic income now or to reduce the working hours. When in Greece working hours are being increased, it's like going really against the grain. So then there is the whole question of the political dynamic that would produce these changes, which is something we are touching in the book, but wishy-washy. I mean, it's very difficult to say there what's the kind of political dynamic that will create this type of policy or institutional changes. But I would say that it would be a political dynamic that wouldn't be just in the name of degrowth or producing zero growth, but generally changing a system that seems to be doing very bad in terms of inequality and in terms of climate change. What's the role of economic instruments? Generally, in the degrowth literature, we are critical of prices for the reason, and the ecological economics are critical of prices for the reason that I said, that very, very often prices are used to commensurate things that they shouldn't be commensurable with money. And they extend, they commodify things that they shouldn't be commodified, and things whose commodification is part of the problem rather than the solution. On the other hand, we are favorable of taxes, which is an economic instrument that we're pretty favorable of, which means like a government that would decide what is good and what is bad, what it wants to achieve, and would send the right signals in terms of costs to those who produce and to those who consume. So one basic idea would be to reduce labor taxes, for example, and shift this into carbon or energy taxes. This can be problematic because labor taxes are progressive, the poor pay less, etc. So how would you assure that with an energy taxes you would have the same not regressive effects? But I think this is an open discussion. It's an open invitation to think, how would we redefine the tax system in a way that would be more equitable and also more sustainable? But taxes, yes, are central, not prices.
On the tax, I mean, I'm always wondering, what are you going to do with that extra money? I mean, you can say that you give it back to people. You know, if you tax high energy producing industries and you give it back to people in income tax or whatever way, it's the rebound effect again, and then, you know, there's just going to be more consumption. How would you see that money then being used in a non-degrowth way? Would it be in education or?
mean, one thing is where you do divert the state investments, exactly. So if you divert the state investments or revenue into things that they are less growth or resource intensive and less resource intensive, like education or arts or things that are more resource light, this is one way. The other way is like that already by changing the tax system, you change the incentives of consumption. So if the hamburger starts costing $150, I'm joking. I mean, this sounds too far-fetched, but imagine this extreme scenario. When something costs a lot, you're not going to consume it, even if you receive back a basic income. So then what are you going to do with your basic income? You're going to use your basic income to do things that are going to be affordable for you. And which things are going to be affordable? The ones which are not carbon intensive and therefore they are not taxed very high. So in a way, it's a circular system that changes incentives in the way economists think about changing incentives, but with a strong role for government, which is not very often how these changes are thought of. Yeah?
Yes, I wanted to add one point to your many points about the connection between growth and welfare. And that is the one that growth, to the if it is accompanied or not accompanied with some restructuring, social restructuring, and inequalities, it tends to not do anything about what makes people happy. For example, if I was thinking about the analysis of social distance that an economist at Berkeley, you may know her, I cannot remember her name, who talks about social distance and the effort that that rich people make when somebody below them all of a sudden reaches the same level of consumption. Mm-hmm. And then they do other things to keep get bigger homes or move to the Seychelles in the summertime. They do all kinds of things to keep that social distance. Mm-hmm. And the following action is for those who have reached that level to want to imitate them again. So nothing changes. In fact, it's like useless type of connection to where there is no connection in cases like that. There is no redistribution or restructuring of the social pyramid. It seems to be, useless from that point of view.
Yeah, actually, that's something that interests me a lot. And my chapter in our book is precisely about that. So it's the thesis of social limits to growth. Fred Hirsch wrote that in 1970-something. So that's how he called his book. And it was precisely this argument that he was saying that growth after a level that satisfies basic material uses, then it becomes just growth that goes into positional consumption. And this is a zero-sum game. So you might have more and more growth and pay for more and more expensive houses, but it's always relative. So the house is more expensive, it's not any better, no? But to get a house in Val Vidrera, you will always have to pay five times more the average annual salary or something, And the average annual salary goes up, the house in Val Vidrera also goes up, and then nothing really has changed. So you are richer in a way, the economy is producing much, much more. It's extracting many resources from the rest of the world. For why? To maintain a system that someone has a house in Val Vidrera and someone has a house in San Andreu. That's the only difference. And this is, he called it social scarcity. And he said social scarcity, which is the scarcity of goods that they are positional, like a house with a nice view or a house that it's big and it's in the best location, that this can never be resolved with more growth. It's a positional scarcity. It's like we cannot all be the ones who have the best houses because the best house, only one will have it, no? Or a few. So that's, by definition, is scarce. It's not something that you can respond to.
Una pregunta. Porto temps pensant que afegir l'adjectiu ecological Ecological Economics, ens treu valor i fa que no estiguem discutint de cara al gran públic, de cara a l'acadèmia, el que és l'economia en si mateixa. Nosaltres estem dient, al posar l'adjectiu, que bueno, que no som economia, som una altra cosa. Llavors, a l'hora d'arribar al gran públic, que és qui haurà de canviar el seu comportament per assolir una societat de creixement, no? A través del consum, penso que ha de ser la persona, no? L'acció pròpia aquí. Bueno, però aleshores, com que no estem discutint el concepte d'economia, i estem al objectiu, em sembla que no s'està fent del tot bé. No sé si...
It's a tricky question in the sense economics, I mean, it's the whole discussion also about changing economics, changing the economic curriculum. So economics now has settled around a certain set of ideas now. So there is neoclassical economics, which is the dominant one, which is what is being taught at schools, and it's what is understood in colloquial terms also as economics. And then you have some radical schools of thought. I mean, you have Keynesianism, and then you might have Marxist political economy at the most extreme, no? Or critical economy there, that it's criticizing this field, but it's using a little bit, to some extent, or the same numbers, or some similar concepts. Marxism, less and less so. But, and this is the body of thought. And then you have what I described here, which is very different now, because we are talking about calories, we are talking about carbon emissions, we are talking about the economy as a metabolic system, we are talking about incommensurable values. So the whole thing is different. So should we call it economics and try to occupy space within economics? I would go for that approach. But unfortunately, people much better than me tried it and failed in the 70s and 80s, that they were economists, they had strong positions, and they didn't manage to get this field of thought within economics. So it was considered too different, too not economics for economists to accept it. So I am all in favor of trying to change the curriculum and trying to change economics itself and make it more ecological. I'm not very optimistic, though, that... especially the ecological dimension of it. The critical and the opening more the neoclassical model and including, I don't know, behavioral economics and including also more Keynesian. This is happening and it's very good. It's nice. And there are students also who are fighting for this, and this is very good. But there's not a direction towards the ecological economics. And I think the problem is that what we are talking about here is quite different. It's very different. So it's in a sense incompatible. I wish economic departments had also one position for ecological economists, but with few exceptions, one or two departments here in Spain, none in the US. Like in the US, all the ecological economists are in environmental science departments, none of them are in economics departments. Then sometimes also about myself, I think, where when a journalist asks me, I say I'm an ecological economist, not an economist. Should I say I'm an economist? I mean, one reason is I don't feel I'm an economist because I don't have a PhD in economics, but... yeah, you could say I'm an economist and try to say we're doing is economics.
Ladies first.
I wonder if you can go back to the Paris conference. Mm-hmm. And at the beginning you talked about your argument about the carbon tax. Can you talk a little bit more about that? Can you discuss a bit more what type of agreement would need to be established in order to have a reality of deep growth?
I mean, independent of degrowth, I think for climate change, I mean, my assumption, but I might be wrong, is that if we reach the right type of agreement, this would require fundamental economic restructuring in the type of degrowth. But I mean, let's forget this question. Say, like, isolate the question of climate change, and we say we want to get carbon emissions down, no, to within 1.5 degrees or 2 degrees Celsius of change, no? What would this require? This would require all that we know that has worked in the past in terms of international agreements, which is nations coming together, setting binding targets, agreeing on these targets, and then implementing them with regulation and with real structural changes and policies to implement these policies and really reduce their carbon emissions, including the trade, full stop. You know, we know that this works. This is how the ozone problem was kind of addressed, but it was a much easier problem in a sense because it wasn't so central for the economy. It wasn't fossil fuels. It was things going in the refrigerators. Okay, this you can change, you know? But like the things going in the cars, it's more difficult to change. So we know what works, but it's really, really difficult to do it. So what the Paris Agreement did is like it promised it will do that, but without any of the binding instruments there. So the promise is, again, either through some kind of technological miracle that will happen in the future. So a lot of people are putting bets there. The nuclear lobby is back and saying, like, nuclear energy is clean, etc. Others are saying about geoengineering. But these are bets which, even if they were to work and not create new problems, that, of course, they will, they would take 50 years. So, I mean, they are not even feasible in their own terms. And then the other argument that you have is like, okay, look at economies like Sweden, you know, they are growing and they are reducing their emissions by 20%, why cannot everyone do the same? And I argued why I think not everyone can do the same, you know, because there are other countries which are producing industrial products right now. There's China, there are, Sweden is importing a lot of stuff. And plus, even what Sweden is doing is not enough at the global scale to reach the carbon emission targets. So I think much more decisive action is needed, but it is not taken precisely because it goes against the standard pattern of economic growth. That's the problem.
And sorry, the one thing that I missed in the question perhaps was, is it required to have a carbon tax within that agreement?
I mean, it's one of the instruments. I think what you need is to have a carbon cap, and carbon cap meets a limit of how much carbon you emit, and then really go out and implement it, not say that we're going to have markets that they might approximate, or we might have voluntary measures, or each one will do their best and maybe reach it. No, you have to have a limit. That's how environmental regulation worked in the past. You know, you put a limit and then you put the force of the government to implement it. Of course, the government now is really weakened. We are in a different era. We are not in the 70s, but that's how things work. Collective action coming together and then decisively implementing it and changing your economy and your society along the way, transforming in this. These are not easy things to happen. But that's the only way.
No, no, pardon. Verses.
In classical economy, we talk about the metabolism of material and energy, but we don't talk about the metabolism of information. Then in biology, we have the metabolism of material, energy, and also information. Genetics, sexuality. And in neoclassical economy, we talk about the construction of information with theories of efficiency, jobs, but in classical economy, because we don't talk about the information, the metabolism of information. Well, Malthusian is yes, it's a thing. But the sexuality, you have to talk about the political woman movement. This is the construction of information of sexuality and economy. But I think that we talk very few about the theories of information that exists in the economy and exists in biology.
Yeah. You know, you're right. You're absolutely right. And I think ecological economics is less ecological in that sense, that ecology and biology are dealing with information. I think we're not dealing that well, or I'm not dealing that well. I know that people like Robert Ayres, who is also an ecological economist, he has tried to bring the information into the analysis and bring it together with energy, etc. And there are people who are trying to do that, but it's not a field I know well. But I agree absolutely with you that it's essential. Especially it's essential in order to tackle today's debates, because very often the argument I meet when I make this argument that I made here very often is like that I'm underplaying and ignoring the potentially transformative effect of also information technologies, new communication technologies, new ways of doing things. And it's true that I feel that I don't handle very well this type of argument.
Just a short question that has come to my mind the discussion. How can we make compatible the growing economy with the growing population, especially in the less developed countries? Because this is a serious problem at world level.
I mean, beginning would be for the economy to stabilize at least on per capita levels. But the predictions now of demographers are that there is kind of a population peak which will be around 9 billion by 2050. So on the basis of current fertility rates, the prediction is like kind of a peaking by 2050. I mean, the interesting thing is now you read the editorials of The Economist or Wall Street Journal, and they're already framing this as a problem. So they're saying, and in Piketty's book also it's framed as a problem. So Piketty is saying for the main reason why growth is going to stagnate, he doesn't see it as a problem, but he frames it in this way. He says the main reason why growth is going to stagnate is because population is stagnating, and that's a fact of demography. So then you have now a whole literature, scientific and also political scientific, that it's making the argument we should have again pro population growth policies, because we are getting in sort of, we, capital is getting short of cheap workers, because like there are less and less people, so the wages are going to go up, which of course is a wonderful thing, you know. But from the point of view of growth, it sounds bad, because wages are going to go up, so productivity is going to reduce, so like there's not going to be the same level of growth. So in one sense, I would say that the trends and the data right now with population are on our side, in the sense that it's peaking, and this is also good because it's bringing growth to a halt. And it's also increasing the relative bargaining power of labor and wages. But my fear is that now you're going to have the counterforce, which is against to try to stimulate population growth. You saw that China, for example, I mean, you might argue about the one-child policy and how draconian it was, but it removed it now, if I'm not wrong, no? So we are again back to this trend of increasing population.
Unfortunately, we have only time for one last question, if there is. Yes, Mr. Monson. Ah, there are two.
I can take
two. Ladies first.
I can take two together and then answer.
I found very interesting your explanation, very persuasive. But it seems to me that there's one basic question, which is politics. So the diagnosis is very persuasive and very, very detailed and careful. But what about politics?
Mm-hmm. And your question, Mr. Montserrat? You would take both questions together.
It's more or less the same.
Okay.
Estava pensant en les obres de Wolfgang Harich, el caràcter coercitiu de tota solució. I em sembla que si els peus no poden intervenir com a element central, etc, etc, al final hem d'acabar pensant en una solució coercitiva.
Una solució?
Coercitiva.
Coercitiva. Yeah.
He wrote a book called Communism with Andro. It was
Miss Van Dell. I am old, so I
that's the reason why I love this book.
I don't believe in the politics, so the two questions. I have a lot of opinions and a lot of work on the political question, but I didn't want to put it on the forefront. But I would say that I see my role, let's say, on adding a different line of diagnosis of the crisis and the causes of the crisis, that they are not even prevalent among those who are critical of the system and the call for political change. So even with those who are criticizing certain aspects of the system, I think this line of criticism, the ecological criticism, is ecological critical, the ecological economic is very often missing. So that's what I'm doing. I think on the side of the political change, I don't have much to add, not in the sense that we found the solution, but in terms that there are many other interesting people doing fantastic work, both on the ground level of doing actual political work and on the philosophical and analytical level of trying to understand how big systems change take place. So I don't think degrowth per se has something to offer there, rather than take ideas also from there and put them in the mix. But I mean, whatever dynamic or whatever political dynamic is to bring a progressive change would bring also this change, although there is the danger that it might be progressive change but still carbon intensive progressive change. So I'm trying to put this on the table. But of course it's the most central question. I don't think it has to be coercive. So I don't believe in coercion against the wish of the people. So who would be this enlightened elite that would come on power to coerce the rest of us that would want growth or would want to consume more? Not to. And why would they do that? So I don't see from where this power of some ecological dictatorship or ecological coercive state would emerge from. I think the only chance that this would happen if there is a popular move that wants this thing and then creates a state that does this thing for itself. But I can't see from where this external coercion would come. And I mean, coercive states right now are pro-growth as much as it gets, because of course they also want to maintain their stability. The people still want growth, they want more consumption, so the dynamic is always one of growth. So I don't see that. And I think precisely because it's a more difficult change and it's not the natural state of things, it would need also a kind of change of everyday politics, of everyday values, much more transformation of the society that then the state would take up rather than a coercive state putting it on us.
I think that is the moment to thank very much Professor Kallis about his explanation and mainly also about his answers to our questions. So thank you to all of you for coming. Please be free to come again to the Catalan Economic Society conferences. You are invited to come and to cooperate with us. So, Professor Kallis, thank you. Moltes gràcies, Ejaristo.